We begin with a commitment from the federal government to improve the mental health of Australians following a shocking report on its impact. Here's Kerry Axley.
It's been described as a national crisis and one of the biggest policy challenges facing the country. The Productivity Commission has released its draft report looking at the economic impact of mental health in Australia. It found mental illness and suicide costs approximately $500 million a day, or $180 billion a year. One in five experience it, and 75% first experience symptoms before the age of 25.
It is a significant challenge. There are big dividends if we can get it right. That $180 billion, I'm not saying that you can reduce that to zero, but we could certainly make a dent in that with the right sort of early intervention, prevention and the multifaceted approach.
The Commission recommends a major focus on helping young people with early intervention, including social and emotional screening of babies and toddlers and placing wellbeing officers in every school. Prime Minister Scott Morrison says youth mental health is one of his government's highest priorities. Here is his Health Minister Greg Hunt responding to the report.
We want to have a single unified mental health system so it's easy to understand and people can get the services they need, when they need them, where they need them.
Labor's health spokesperson Chris Bowen says the approach to mental health needs a revolution, not evolution, meaning, he says, substantial policy change from the government.
And if you or someone you know is struggling to cope, you can contact Lifeline on 13 11 14. A married couple missing in regional Victoria since Monday has been found alive and well in Gippsland. Guy and Susan Beasley, who'd become disoriented, managed to flag down help from Parks Victoria officers around midday. The alarm was raised on Monday after they didn't return home from visiting friends and family over the weekend. It was a loud and chaotic morning in Melbourne with more disruptive protest action outside a mining conference. Stephanie Anderson is there for us. Steph, they've now moved on.
They absolutely have, Belinda. Over the past few days, we've seen this space out the front of the Convention and Exhibition Centre packed with protesters. But as you can see this afternoon, it's just myself and a few dozen police officers that have been left here with these demonstrations well and truly dying down around midday today. Now, what we did see this morning, though, was still a significant number of protesters turning out, but police were certainly on a mission to be on the front foot. What we saw was a line of police horses setting up essentially a barricade, and then also public order response members creating the other side of that barricade and giving delegates a clear path to actually get through the front door of the convention centre and into this conference. Now, over past days, they're the opportunities where we've seen protesters being in the face of delegates. We've also seen spitting and them being pulled to the ground. We've also seen a number of delegates biting back at the protesters. But today, that was very much not the case. The behaviour was significantly more subdued. We obviously did still see that loud shouting, though, as the delegates walked through the front door. We had several hundred police who were here keeping a close eye on proceedings. This is the third and final day of this conference as it stands, and that obviously means that the demonstrations too are wrapping up. I spoke to one of the organisers earlier this morning. Here's what she had to say.
We feel absolutely elated at the success we've had in informing the public about this disgusting conference.
A lot of what's going on inside is actually trying to help that, but all they can see is a negative.
Now, one of the final parts of the demonstrations this morning was a march through the city. We saw traffic stopped, trams stopped as well, as the protesters made their way to the headquarters of Rio Tinto. They stood out the front, they made speeches and chanted again, and that's where they've essentially dispersed from. And we've come back here to the convention centre where they have essentially stayed away from at this point. Now, we do understand there is another action planned at around 6 this evening. As for the turnout for that, well, that remains to be seen, Belinda.
Plenty more to come. Thanks for that, Steph. The hazardous smoke haze choking parts of New South Wales is expected to linger for several days as more than 50 bushfires burn on the state's mid-north coast. While authorities have issued a health warning, some people were undeterred.
I landed from Hong Kong at 6:30 this morning, and this looks actually relatively good compared to the Hong Kong air.
Children, the elderly and people suffering from heart and lung conditions are being urged to stay indoors. Sydney's public transport network is still playing catch-up after yet another morning of delays on the Northwest Metro line. A breakdown at North Ryde Station caused the drama, forcing commuters into long lines to catch a bus, and they weren't happy about it.
Sydney Metro have got no contingency plan. The train breaks down, we're left with our own devices. You know, they don't tell us what's happening, they just say, find your own mode of transport. And it's not good enough.
The New South Wales Transport Minister has vowed to solve the issues plaguing the metro. A toddler is undergoing specialist surgery after being hit by his father's reversing car and dragged 5 metres along a driveway near the Gold Coast. This update from Jordan Fabris.
Well, this toddler is currently in the fight of his very young life in the Gold Coast University Hospital behind me after being accidentally run over by his father in a car in their family home at Wongawollen, just west of the Gold Coast. Critical care paramedics and police arrived to the family home just after 6:30 this morning, finding the two-year-old boy suffering significant injuries after being reversed over by the car. After being stabilised by paramedics, he was rushed to hospital where he remains in a critical condition. Nine News has been told the father of the boy is understandably distraught with what happened and is currently by his bedside. Police say while an absolutely tragic event, it is a timely reminder to all parents to be aware of their surroundings and where their children are at all times.
I believe the driver is in shock, but otherwise okay, and he's obviously very concerned for the safety of the child.
The boy is expected to undergo specialist treatment throughout the day. He suffered a broken arm, a broken leg and injuries to his face. His condition is currently listed as critical.
Family comes first when it comes to the NRL's Burgess brothers. This was Luke Burgess leaving Cabo Airport, where little brother Sam has been partying. There's been no sign of the Rabbitohs star this week since revealing his shock retirement from the NRL due to injury. Hours after that sudden announcement came the news Sam has been charged with intimidation over an alleged confrontation with his father-in-law. Luke made no comment to the cameras as he flew out of Mexico. There's concern this morning over a Commonwealth Bank education program for children. Consumer group Choice claims the program, which sometimes runs in conjunction with the Dolomite school banking scheme, is teaching children as young as 10 how to use credit cards. Research has found about 1 million Australians are trapped in a cycle of credit card debt.